on the podcast from Final Draft. This is the podcast where we talk about screenwriting, filmmaking, and everything in between. I'm your host, Phil Galasso. Today we have an interview with Liz Feldman, creator of the Netflix show Dead to Me, starring Christina Applegate and Linda Cardellini. The show follows two grieving women who bond during therapy, but there are a lot of twists, turns, and laughs along the way. Liz and I discuss the shifting tones of the show, her work writing on Two Broke Girls, how she got her start as a writer, and more. Check it out. I'm going to jump right in. Liz Feldman, thank you for taking the time to join us.
You're so welcome. Thanks for having me.
So Dead to Me season two is coming up. For our listeners who maybe are unfamiliar with the show or watched season one when it came out and, you know, a lot's happened since then, can you give everybody a little bit of an idea of what the show is and what to expect in season two?
Dead to Me is what I like to describe as a genre non-conforming, twisty, turny, funny, heartfelt show about two women navigating their way together through immense loss and grief.
Yes, so genre nonconforming is definitely something, a good way to describe the show. Talk about that, because the show, you know, it goes from madcap comedy to really dark, episodes about grief and things like that. Talk about navigating those different tones and how you do that.
Well, I mean, I think what I was trying to do with the vacillating tones is reflect my experience of life. You know, on any given day, your life can feel like a madcap comedy, or it can feel like a gritty drama. You know, and there are twists and turns that happen to all of us, you know, that if you sort of just told a story and explained, you know, this crazy thing that happened, nobody would believe you. But these things really do happen all the time to us in our lives. And so I wanted to see, you know, what would happen if I allowed myself to just, you know, ignore the box of genre and just not try to make, you know, this show like just a comedy or just a drama or just a thriller, but really, you know, sort of put myself in these characters' shoes and in their situation and, you know, see what happens to them. And, you know, I think that's what you see on the show is, you know, people living their lives, you know, these ordinary women who are living through extraordinary circumstances and doing their best to, you know, keep their feet on the ground and be there for each other along the way.
You know, I talk to a lot of writers and, you know, one of the things that comes up, especially in television is, you know, in your writer's room, you have to pour your soul out. You really have to have a level of trust on a show that deals with such, you know, such deep issues. What's it like in the writer's room for you?
Well, I mean, that's absolutely, you know, that's right. I, you know, when I'm doing the hiring process and bringing new writers on, you know, let them know that the expectation is like that we're all going to be really open. And, you know, that because I want the show to feel, though it's heightened, I want, you know, the characters to feel real. I want the audience to really be able to relate to them and feel for them and see their own lives, you know, reflected in the characters. And the way to do that, I think, is to, you know, have our writers, you know, really share their own lives and imbue, you know, we all sort of imbue our own stories and our experiences and our heartbreaks, you know, into the show. So, you know, the room is like a really lovely place, you know, where I hope, you know, that the writers feel really comfortable to be vulnerable, to be open, to, you know, maybe explore, you know, the dark side of certain events that have happened in their lives. And, you know, what you see, especially, you know, if you've seen the first season, you know, yeah, so I mean, I think, you know, it's sort of, I think, what you'd expect. It's, you know, we have a majority female writer's room, and it's a really, like, hopefully safe place to just share, you know, different experiences, losses, loves that we've all had, and, you know, make our characters and, you know, the story richer for it.
So when you're plotting out the show in the room, I'm curious, because, you know, it's obviously a very character-based show, but there are twists and turns and, you know, that come pretty fast, you know, fast and furious at you. In the room, when you're plotting it out, when you're plotting out a season, do you kind of set benchmarks for yourself? Do you know where you're going, or how are you figuring the story out, you know, episode to episode and then, you know, for the full season arc?
Sure. I mean, the first season, I had a lot of that figured out ahead of time because I had to pitch, you know, the entire show to Netflix. You know, I wasn't just, you know, selling an idea. I was really selling, like, here's what the pilot is, here's the second, you know, through 10th episode. But once you get in a writer's room, that changes, you know? So there were definitely benchmarks the first season. Like, you know, I knew that Jen's, spoiler alert, sorry, if anybody.
Hopefully they watched the first season.
Yeah, hopefully you've watched the first season. You know, I obviously had the pilot all figured out. You know, I knew that Jen's husband had an affair. I knew that they were going to find out. I knew that they were going to go and, you know, seek out the young woman that he had the affair with. I knew they were going to go to a grief retreat. I knew that Judy was going to meet a cop there. You know, there were a lot of things that were definitely benchmarks I knew to hit in that first season. Once you get into a second season, because we ended the first season the way we did, with, you know, Steve floating face down in a pool, that's actually not how I intended. That's not part of my original pitch to Netflix. So, you know, because we took this very big swing with that, you know, it really ended up, you know, setting the second season on a completely other path than what I was expecting. So, you know, with season two, when I came into the writer's room, I had a few things I knew I wanted to have happen. I don't want to spoil it for anybody, but there were a few benchmarks I knew, mm-hmm. but really, you know, it was up to the room and I together to come up with, you know, the full fledged story of the season, including the finale, which, have you seen it now?
Or? I have not, no.
Okay. Well, then I don't want to ruin
I want to talk a little bit about the performances on the show because, again, going back to what we were discussing earlier with the, you know, the different tones, the performances, I think it becomes really important that they're able to, you know, credibly go from comedy to drama sometimes, you know, from one scene to another. So can you talk about what Christina and Linda bring to the show?
I mean, Christina and Linda are everything, you know. This would be a very different show in the hands of lesser actors. You know, you are incredibly bound to the talent, you know, that you are working with. And which is, for me, incredibly fortunate because honestly, all I do on set is like sit in awe of what these two women and James Marsden when he's in it. I mean, and Deanna Maria Riva and Natalie Morales, you know, Sam McCarthy, Luke Rossler, they're all incredibly good actors. But, you know, obviously the bulk of the show is Christina and Linda. And I mean, they're absolutely remarkable. And when we were first shooting the season one, because this is a different kind of show, it's not obviously a comedy or a drama, you know, the task of the first few episodes is finding that tone and making sure that there's a consistency of tone. And I remember like after like the first or second day, Christina called me and she's like, I don't know if I'm doing this right. Like, what is the tone of this show? And I was like, you're the tone of the show. Like your ability to be funny and then heartbreaking in the same scene, that's the tone of the show. Your darkness, you know, set against your lightness, that is the tone of the show. And, you know, and Linda embodies that beautifully as well, you know, and they're, you know, I just really got lucky that I have two actresses who are adept at comedy and adept at drama, you know, surprisingly so, because I don't know that people thought of Christina as somebody, you know, who was going to be, you know, in a show where she was going to cry a lot or, you know, and, you know, it's an incredible gift to be able to watch them do what they do because they're just so good. Mm-hmm. And that has nothing to do with me. That's just, they're really good. And so they take whatever material we write and they elevate it. And that's mm-hmm. all you could wish for with your cast.
I want to jump back a little bit and talk about some of the other shows you've worked on and just kind of work our way through. So this is your second show that you've created and mm-hmm. showrun, but you've also worked on a number of other shows, Two Broke Girls. Can you talk about first got your start as a writer and sort of take us?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, my start is a bit of an odd one. I was a stand-up comic as a teenager. I'm from Brooklyn and I would go into the city and play clubs and it was, you know, sort of a weird thing for a teenager to do. And that's what I did. And when about 3 weeks after I graduated from high school, I was, I guess you would say, scouted by or discovered by Nickelodeon. And they hired me to be on their show, All That. And they were interested in me potentially writing for it. And they asked my manager at the time, like, who writes her stand-up material? And he said, she does. And I weirdly had also been writing material for other kids. It was like a whole group of us teenagers doing stand-up. And, you know, I sort of stumbled into writing in that way. You know, I started writing jokes just for myself, for, you know, to do on stage. Then all of a sudden I'm writing jokes for other kids. And then, you know, I guess, you know, the people on All That, like, saw something potential there, you know, and they really turned me into a writer by hiring me to write for that show. So that was, you know, right out of high school, which is, you know, has its positives and negatives. It wasn't the best experience. I didn't really enjoy being in that writer's room. I was the only female writer. Again, I had just turned 18. I was a child, basically. Mm-hmm. And it was not a good environment for a young woman. You know, it actually sort of pushed me away from writing. I felt a bit repelled by the experience. I went to college at Boston University, where I actually studied television. Believe it or not, I have a BS in TV, aptly named. And then, you know, when I came out to LA, I did The Groundlings for 5.5 years and Second City, and I was pursuing life as a performer. But, you know, I kept having this sort of voice in my head say, like, you know, there's this other thing that you could do that you could, like, maybe try to make a living at. And, you know, eventually when I was about 26, you know, I sat down with my manager, different manager than when I was a teenager, with my adult manager.
Big boy manager.
With my big girl manager, yes. Her name is Christy Smith. We started working together when I was 24 and she was 25. We still work together today, and she's an executive producer of Bed to Me.
Oh, excellent.
18 years we've been working together. And I just sort of, I realized, you know, I could probably try to write again. And when I decided that, things happened pretty quickly for me, which is incredibly lucky. I think timing is everything, and I happen to have good timing. And I pretty shortly after that conversation with her, got a job writing on Blue Collar TV in 2003, 2004, something like that. And I that's sort of what got me, you know, back into writing. And, you know, that was a sketch show primarily. And I decided, like, okay, I think I could actually do this. Like, you know, it was a more positive experience than the first one I had. But I was also sort of longing to write material and write for someone who I was a bit more sort of simpatico with, like aligned with. And I had always more than admired, I mean, totally worshipped Ellen. And I was lucky enough, coming off of Blue Collar TV, to get a job writing on her talk show. You know, and I wrote for her for the Oscars, and sort of, you know, got back to my joke writing roots. And, you know, after a few years of working on her show, which was a great experience, I was really longing to tell stories. I just, you know, I had been in this sort of short form world for so long, and I wanted to challenge myself, and I felt like I had something to say, and I wanted to be able to say it in my voice. And so I left the show and started pursuing, you know, pilots and that kind of thing. And, you know, one thing led to the next, and I got my first, you know, staffing job on Hot in Cleveland, the first season of Hot in Cleveland, and, you know, which got me into a sitcom room. And, you know, I did sitcoms for many, many years, including Two Broke Girls and my own show, One Big Happy, which was short-lived, but a fun run on NBC. And I think, you know, coming off of that, I was really sort of jealous of people who could tell stories in more than 21.5 minutes. And, you know, I obviously, like, the streaming world was, you know, becoming far more tangible, you know, to writers. And so that's sort of like my trajectory into Dead to Me.
And you talk about, you know, sort of the, some of the skills and things you've learned along the way from, you know, working on different shows that you then bring to your, you know, your current role as a showrunner and a creator?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I would say from my earlier jobs, like with, especially like working for Ellen, I developed like a real work ethic because of her work ethic. And, you know, that is to say, I never just settle for something that's fine or good. You know, Ellen is a, you know, a perfectionist. She's a hard worker. She wants, you know, she's also the funniest person in the world. So you gotta, if you're going to write a joke for her, it should be the best possible joke you can write. And I took that with me, like, here's how a person becomes excellent, you know, by always pushing themselves and by never settling for something that's adequate, you know, when you could actually reach for something that's great. So I'm always trying to reach for great, you know, and not settle for good enough. And, you know, coming into the sitcom world, I mean, I learned a tremendous amount, just some real practical things like, you know, how to break a story, how to structure a script, how to, you know, set yourself up for act breaks and things like that. You know, the most obvious stuff, but stuff that really becomes sort of second nature when you're in a room, you know, and without the experience of being in those rooms, like you can read about it, but it's not being sort of worked into your muscle memory. So it's just being able to work on shows, like you just sort of start developing this muscle of like, oh, I don't know if that story is going to make sense, or like, actually it feels like this person should want this, or, you know, some of the most basic tenets of writing that seem obvious, but, you know, until you're kind of in it, you're like, oh, right, that's really, it's really important for everybody to want something. In a scene. You know, and then working on Two Broke Girls was a pretty incredible experience and a rarefied experience because the show was immediately a hit. So, it just was, I think 20 million people watched that first episode, you know, which by today's standards is just unheard of. And, you know, this is only 9 years ago. And, to have this sort of experience of being on a show that does well kind of out of the gate, and it was sort of immediately put into syndication in a way that had never really been done before, it was a really special sort of experience to feel what success feels like, kind of. You know what I mean? Like, it's because once you have a feeling, like once you have an experience, I think in a weird way, it's easy to magnetize more of it. But if you've never had the experience of being on a show that does well, like, it's hard to imagine what that would feel like. So I feel really grateful that I just got to have that experience and the excitement of like, oh my God, the show's actually clicking and people are watching it and it's, you know, a hit, quote unquote. And I also learned a lot from Michael Patrick King, who is the showrunner. You know, for better and for worse, you know, I learned things I would do, things I wouldn't do, but he also gave me an incredible gift, which is that he saw something in me. And I remember one day on set, we were, he was maybe directing and we were shooting an episode, and he was looking at all the cameras and I was sort of standing right over his shoulder. And I was like, I don't know. I sort of like gave him a note, which is a bit of a no-no. And he kind of like looked at me and he was like, you think you could do this better than me, don't you? And I, you know, and he was like sort of tongue in cheek and I kind of tongue in cheek back at him. And I said, yeah, I do. And he just sort of laughed and he's like, you're a showrunner. You're going to be a showrunner. And he kind of like in a weird way anointed me, which gave me the confidence to feel like, oh, maybe I could do that. And, you know, so he really, you know, took me under his wing a little bit and, you know, would sort of, you know, in a way here and there be like, here's what you want to do. Here's what you don't want to do. And I feel, you know, just grateful that he saw that in me and sort of helped, you know, push me in that direction. So, yeah, I mean, I think it's important for every job, you know, that you do, that you get something out of it, that you become a better writer because of it. And that could happen in the most unexpected of ways. You know, I've worked on shows that probably if I even said the name, you'd be like, what? But, you know, like they might have been blips, but I got something out of it. And, you know, I'm interested in constantly growing and evolving as a writer and challenging myself to tell stories in a different way. And, you know, just to go deeper and, you know, find that surprising thing, you know, that even surprises me.
that's all really great. I'm curious what your writing process is. As the, you know, what's a typical writing day for you? Are you do you have deadlines? Do you wake up early? Are you a big procrastinator? What's your...
Well, it really depends, you know, on what's happening in the moment. I have not written anything during this quarantine because I just finished season two. I literally, as California was being put on lockdown, I was doing the finishing touches of post-production on the show. Normally right now, this would be my break. This is my, you know, little hiatus. So I try not to stress myself out and pressure myself to write, you know, if there really isn't anything, you know, looming over me. I am definitely a gun to the head kind of writer, so to speak. I need the pressure of a deadline. I need people expecting something from me. I left to my own devices. If I'm just doing it to please myself, it's probably not going to happen in any kind of timely fashion. But, you know, I mean, so yeah, you know, I mean, I think like, when I was writing the pilot, you know, I was being paid to do so. And, you know, there are people, you know, in a tall building waiting for me to finish, and feeling that pressure is very motivating. Mm-hmm. So, you know, on a day like that, I would, you know, give myself a leisurely morning, but I certainly would go to work. And for me, if I'm just writing solo, I don't write for more than about 4 hours at a time. I find that what I can get done in that amount of time is about the same as if I forced myself to tack on 2 or 3 hours. I would just end up, you know, spacing out or checking the internet. But if I know, hey, you have 4 hours to write as much as you can, I that feels like a tangible, doable thing. And I will just sort of force myself to sit there and do it. You know, obviously, when you're in production or when you're in pre-production and you're in a writer's room, there's the deadline is like, you know, it is this ever looming piano about to drop from 50 lights up over your head. And, you know, you have to just keep on a real clip. But there's, you know, at least probably a month of just chatting and breaking story and stuff like that. And then ideally, you know, if there's enough time, I like to send everybody off to write at the same time, or, you know, slightly staggered, but, you know, and you get a week to write an episode and feels kind of leisurely and nice. And yeah, sort of my meandering answer to the question.
In the room, you know, you just mentioned, you know, you like to, you'll send the individual writers out to write their episodes. How detailed are you breaking episodes down? Because I've seen, you know, some rooms they'll have like literally every single story beat, even lots of the dialogue will be generated in the room. And then I've seen, I know others are a little bit more liberal with, you know, okay, here's, you know, what happens at the beginning of the episode, and here's what happens at the end, here's the journey the characters take, and, you know, go do your job. So I'm just curious how detailed you're getting in the room.
Well, we do a detailed outline, you know, for each episode. So, you know, that outline is going to have the beginning, middle, and end of every scene, probably some snippets of dialogue, and definitely the emotional journey for the character. And, you know, at our best, when we have time, we send people off with a very detailed outline that they could, you know, really, really work off of for the script, where they're mainly just filling in dialogue. But, you know, there have also been times where it's like, okay, here's a scene. Like, for example, in season one, there's an episode, it's episode 7, where Judy and Steve are taking apart the car, you know, and we knew that there was going to be a scene where they were going to have what we would call like almost a downbeat, but where they're getting into a conversation about some history of their relationship. And the writer, you know, we didn't necessarily say they're talking about the petrified forest and the trip that they took, and he took the rock. That's the writer added all of that. Emma Rathbone, you know, that was all from her brain. And she's like, I don't know, I tried something, and like, I knew it was supposed to be something like about their relationship. So here's my take on it. And I absolutely loved it and didn't change a word. You know, so there is some freedom, you know, within certain scenes, you know, where as long as it ends a certain way, you can kind of fill stuff in. You know, and I like to hire writers whose writing I enjoy. So the idea is to like give them a little bit of a palette, you know, with some guidelines, but like, please do your thing. Make this better than I can.
As we're wrapping up, you've been forewarned about my last question.
Oh, shit, right.
You know, you've had a pretty interesting career up to this point. Now you have this amazing show. Is there something you learned or some things you've learned along the way that, you know, you wish you could go back to tell that young writer who's, you know, in that writer's room and all that, or even, you know, before then, any lessons you would like to impart to your younger self?
I mean, I guess I would, there are probably a few lessons I wish I could impart to myself and some criticism too, but I think, you know, first and foremost, I would say reframe your failures. You know, if you're going to be in this business and you're going to have a long career, you're going to face a lot of rejection. You're going to face cancellation, and, you know, you're going to face things being out of your control in a way that makes you feel like you failed. And, you know, having had a short-lived show on the air that, you know, obviously didn't get a second season, it's easy to look at that as a failure. It's easy to look at, you know, a show getting canceled as, you know, letting other people down or not living up to, you know, your potential. And, you know, I think I wish I could have known that failure can also be looked at as like a gift, you know, and that every experience you have, positive or negative, leads you to the next one you're about to experience. And if I hadn't had my experience of, you know, becoming a showrunner for the first time, getting a show on the air, which by the way was an incredibly joyous experience. I loved making One Big Happy. It was a really happy time for me creatively, personally. I loved my cast. We had a really like lovely thing going, but you know, it just wasn't meant to be, and it wasn't going to be longer than a short little season. But coming off of that, I was, you know, I was really down, and I really blamed myself, and you know, felt a full like deflation of confidence. And it took a while to get my sort of spirit back, and I wish I could have had the perspective to say like, hey, look, like you're gonna land on your feet and you're gonna figure out an even better vehicle for yourself, you know? So I would say like, just trust that even the no's make way for the yeses.
I think that is a great note to end on. Dead to Me, season one is right now on Netflix. So if you haven't already caught up with it, now's the time. And then season two drops, this week?
Yeah, drops Friday or Thursday at midnight if you're really excited.
All right. I encourage everybody to check it out. Liz, thank you so much.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thanks again to Liz Feldman for coming on the show. Dead to Me is available to stream on Netflix right now. And of course, thanks to you, our listeners. If you like this episode, leave us a review. And if you haven't already, subscribe on Apple Podcasts. For news about future episodes and more, like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter at Final Draft Inc. and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This episode was produced by Kayla Guess. Editing and post-production done by Sadie Dean. Music is by Santiago Arias. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, write on.